welcome to the Libertarian Alliance. We have a meeting here every month, and you're welcome to the future ones as well as this one. Today's speaker is Neil Luck, and he's talking on the "Are All Politicians Psychopaths?" Is that the title?
That's the title. Yes.
How can we not agree with him? Still, never mind. Go ahead, Neil.
Well, it's nice to start with an easy question, but just before I start, I'll give you a little bit about myself, because I know quite a few of you, but I don't know all of you. My name is Neil Locke. My degree long ago was in pure mathematics from Cambridge. I earn my bread as a software consultant. I've been in the software development industry now for, would you believe it, 45 years. These days I do mostly testing and QA. I do pride myself, I'm rather good at breaking software. If I can't break it, probably nobody can. I didn't encounter the ideas of liberty until I was about 35 years old. So I've really only had 28 years in the movement, so I'm a youngster as far as the movement is concerned. Few other things I do as well. I play the tuba in a brass band, and I'm also in my own small way a composer. In fact, I've just composed a Christmas carol and sent it off to the BBC for their BBC Radio 3 carol composition contest. I entered last year and didn't get shortlisted, but I'm hopeful this year. I think it's rather good. I've done a few other interesting things in my time. Back in 1989, I went coast to coast across North America on a bicycle, which is an absolutely wonderful experience. I went from Nova Scotia to California. It's 4,500 miles, it's a long way. In 2012, I self-published a science fiction novel called Going Galactic, and I've also self-published my book of philosophy called Honest Common Sense. And I happened to have one in my rucksack today, and David was happened to start talking about it, and I said, "Oh, David, would you like this copy?" So my liberty essays, I do write liberty essays. A lot of them go on, all of them virtually go on my blog, which is honestcommonsense.co.uk. Some of them I also put on the other LA. I'm not sure that we are so much other so much. We get on better than we used to.
Oh, very much. Yes. Ever since 1905 when Swan gave that talk on Islam.
1905?
Was it 2005? Why do I say 1905? I'm confused.
I can remember the time when relations were not as good as they are now, but they are now good. Another thing I do in the liberty thing, a liberty area, is I'm a regular teacher at Glenn Cripe's Language of Liberty Institute, Liberty Camps. I don't know if you've heard of these. Glenn is an American guy. He gets together groups of students, usually university students. We have anywhere between 15 and 40 in one group. And everything's in English. It usually lasts 5 days. So they get, we do the ideas of liberty in lecture form, and also in talk form. We talk with the people. Sometimes we have somebody doing entrepreneurship as well. And it's great fun. I do mostly the Eastern European camps, Poland and Ukraine, are my specialities. Right, to my subject. Turn on my little thing. Why does it keep on doing that? Oh, I'll have to do. Are politicians psychopaths? That is the subject on which I'm speaking today. Now, there's a meme that's been going around recently, and I've seen it several times in the last few months, that politicians are psychopaths, or if they're not actually psychopaths, at least they have mental disorders, they have something wrong with them. Now, I managed to trace this idea, this meme, back to its origin. It was started by a neurophysiologist called Paul Broks, who, if I remember rightly, was from Birmingham University, back in 2003, when he suggested quite publicly that Tony Blair might be a psychopath. And the evidence he gave for this was Blair's conduct, which led up to the war in Iraq. I decided a little while ago, 3 or 4 months ago, to try to find out, is there any truth in this idea that politicians are psychopaths? So the purpose of tonight is to report to you on what I found. I will say this talk started out as a slide presentation, but I'm doing it tonight without slides. I do have some slides, and I can email them to you afterwards if anyone is interested. So, okay, what is a psychopath? Well, Webster's Dictionary says a psychopath is, quote, a mentally ill or unstable person especially a person affected with antisocial personality disorder. Unquote. So the main thing is antisocial personality disorder is what a psychopath has. The word was coined way back in 1885. Some people use an alternative term, sociopath. And I confess that I find the distinction between sociopaths and psychopaths to be not entirely clear, and it seems even the professionals don't find it entirely clear. But broadly speaking, it seems that psychopaths are born that way, and sociopaths are more made so by their upbringing. Psychopaths also tend to be better able to hide their disorder, so they're more dangerous. I'm not going to talk about sociopathy, I'm going to talk about psychopathy. And believe me, these are difficult words, because you've got psychopathy with a stress on the first syllable, psychopathic with a stress on the third, and sociopathy with a stress on the second to last. So it's not easy. Okay, the first topic I'll mention is Robert D. Hare, as he's a very, very important man who works in this field. He's a Canadian psychologist, and his speciality is experimental psychology. I don't think that would be he'd be a terrible person to meet and be one of his subjects. I don't think it would be very nice. Now, he's in his 80s now. He's officially retired, but he's still very much active. Back in about 1980, he developed something called the PCL. PCL stands for Psychopathy Checklist. At that time, there was no agreement among psychologists on exactly what a psychopath was or how to identify one. So what Robert Hare did was he set out to create a measuring tool so that people could be sure that they're talking about the same things. And since then, his checklist has evolved into a number of different forms. Hare's concept of psychopathy is something, it's a lot more specific than the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, DSM, which some of you may have heard of. That is a much broader thing which aims at a full classification of mental illnesses. So Hare was particularly concerned with this one thing of psychopathy, or as some people call it, sociopathy. Now, I'll give you three quotes from the writings and speakings of Robert Hare. First quote, psychopaths view any social exchange as a feeding opportunity, a contest or a test of wills in which there can be only one winner. Their motives are to manipulate and take ruthlessly and without remorse. That's a strong statement. Quote number two from Robert Hare. Not all psychopaths are in prison. Some are in the boardroom. And quote number three. I always said that if I wasn't studying psychopaths in prison, I'd do it at the stock exchange. Now, my question is, in addition to prisons, boardrooms and stock exchanges, should we perhaps be looking at parliaments and perhaps even government offices as a place to study psychopaths? Well, by the end of tonight, I hope I will have given you an answer to that question. Okay, so how many psychopaths are there? Robert Hare published in 2001 an estimate, which was based on the Canadian population, that about 1% of the population are psychopaths. I think now, if you asked him, he would say that was a bit of an overestimate. The best estimates today are something around half that. There has also been a difference between the US and Canada on the one hand, where psychologists tend to be more inclined to classify people as psychopaths, and the UK, where people tend to shy away from saying you are a psychopath. So in the UK, it really hasn't been generally regarded as more than about 0.5% of people have been psychopaths. The proportion is definitely higher among business executives and chief executive officers. It's been suggested that the proportion might be as high as 4%. Again, this is a US suggestion, so it's probably quite a bit lower than that. And I don't know if you've heard of a book called Snakes in Suits, which is about psychopaths in the workplace. This was co-authored by Robert Hare with a gentleman called Paul Babiak, and it came up with some quite interesting ideas about psychopaths in the workplace. So, what effects do psychopaths have on the rest of us? Well, first, there is a link. I'm not saying there's a definite positive correlation, but there is a certain degree of link between those who bully at school and those who become psychopaths in later life. So it's almost not so much as if bullies become psychopaths, but that bullying is almost a preparation for having these disorders. And Robert Hare is certainly right. Psychopaths can cause a lot of trouble at work. they do have a tendency to behave with unpleasantness and sometimes even cruelty towards those around them while they stuck up to the big bosses. I actually did experience one of such people that I had to work with. It was a new manager, a new broom manager came in at one of my clients. And this gentleman was actually a black South African and very, very intelligent man. But he was extremely unpleasant to some of his staff. And he got a dreadful reputation among the staff. And some people would come out of his office in tears. But one of the really interesting things, which now I know what I know about psychopaths, suggested to me he might be a psychopath, was when I went in there, because I'm an absolute bastard, I just keep things straight. Absolutely, everything is factual when I deal in business. He seemed to be afraid of me. There was something wrong about his mind. He was nasty to everybody else, but he seemed to be afraid of me. So anyway, a couple of factoids about psychopaths in prisons. About 20% of inmates in prisons are psychopaths. This again is US figures. That's quite a lot, and psychopaths are responsible for something like 50% of violent crimes, another factoid. So I hope you'll agree with me that psychopathy is a real problem. Now, Robert Hare's psychopathy checklist, which I spoke of, consists of three elements. First of all, there is a list of items to be assessed. Secondly, there is a scoring system. And thirdly, there is a cutoff score, or there may be more than one cutoff score. There are a number of versions of the test. The original PCL came from 1980. What is known as PCLR, which is a revised version of the test, which dates from 1985, is used today by psychiatrists in the forensic work that they do for courts of law. So when the judge recommends a psychological examinations, that's what they usually use, or it's one of the things they use. And it is regarded as the gold standard for work in this area. The one I'm going to concentrate here is the third version, which was developed in about 1999. It's called PCL-SV. SV stands for screening version. And it was developed for use in psychiatric evaluations and at need in personnel selection. But it does still require a trained psychiatrist to administer it. There was supposed to be a self-assessment version of the test. It was expected early this year, though, as far as I'm aware, it hasn't happened, and I haven't seen any more about that. So, I'll talk briefly about the items in the test. The screening version of the test has 12 items, so it's just 12 simple characteristics that people can have or not have. It's a very simple test, and it's divided into two parts, part one and part two. Mr. Hare is very logical. The six items in part one refer to, and this is Hare's words, selfish, callous, and remorseless use of others. So let me just name and very briefly describe the six items in part one. The first he calls superficial. Superficial people are glib and they have a surface charm and they cultivate a charming personality. That's what a superficial person is. The second is grandiose. Grandiose people tend to be arrogant and they think they're superior human beings to others in some way or other. The third is deceitful. Deceitful people, in Hare's terms, are lying. They're insincere. They're selfish and manipulative. They can be unscrupulous and they can be dishonest. The fourth item in part one is what Hare calls lack of empathy. These people lack sensitivity towards or regard for people in general. Not so much to specific individuals, but to people as a whole. When they meet new people, they can never be quite sure where they are with these individuals. And they do not care what other people think or want. Number five is doesn't accept responsibility. When they've done something wrong, they have a habit of denying that they've done wrong, and they seek to evade accountability for their actions. And the sixth and final item in part one is lack of remorse. Such people have a cold and calculating attitude to others, and they seem to feel no guilt for what they have done to others, even when they've clearly hurt other people. And they lack concern for the losses, pain, and suffering of victims. And you can see, if you've ever sat on a jury, for example, in a criminal court, and if the guy's been convicted, if you've convicted the guy, you can see this attitude is very, very common among criminals. The items in part two refer to what Hare calls chronically unstable and antisocial lifestyle. Number seven is impulsive. These people are foolhardy, they are rash, they are unpredictable, they are erratic, and they can be reckless. Number eight, he calls poor behaviour controls, and he specifically suggests that these people are irritable, easily annoyed, and often become impatient. Number nine, he calls lax goals. There are two, if you like, sub-parts of this. One is living a parasitic lifestyle, just living off other people, and the other is having no realistic long-term goals in life. I personally see these two as slightly different things, but Hare lumps them together for whatever reason. Number 10 is irresponsible. These people are untrustworthy. They repeatedly fail to fulfill or to honour their obligations and their commitments. For example, they fail on a regular basis to turn up for their work, or they fail to do their work to a decent standard again and again. The last two are antisocial behaviour. Number 11 is adolescent antisocial behaviour, what we used to call in the old days juvenile delinquency. And number 12 is adult antisocial behaviour. And I'll add just one interesting aside. There is an item from the PCLR test which was not carried over into the screening version, but that is promiscuous sexual behaviour, which is apparently quite normal among psychopaths. So, on to the scoring system. It's a very, very simple test. Each item is rated on a three-point scale. So on each item, the subject can score 0, 1, or 2. 0 means the item doesn't apply. They don't have that characteristic at all. 2 at the other end means the item definitely applies. They definitely do have it. And 1 is the item applies somewhat. So 1 is essentially each way bet. The scores for the 12 items are then all added together. And there, one of a number of cut-off scores are applied. Now, in Hare's original PCL screening version, the cut-off score is 18. 18 or over means that the individual meets Hare's definition of a psychopath. But there is also another cut-off at 13. 13 plus is what Hare calls a potential psychopath. So we can think there is somebody who is definitely a psychopath, and is definitely dangerous to other people, or almost definitely dangerous, and there is someone who is a potential psychopath and could well be problematic now or in the future. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to introduce someone called Mr. Politico. What Mr. Politico is, he's a cardboard cutout of a politician. So imagine him standing in his pinstripe suit with his briefcase and all that stuff. He has the characteristics that politicians tend to have, and I'm not getting at individual politicians here, and I'm not getting at politicians of a particular party, but I'm just, Mr. Politico has lots of the characteristics that politicians tend to have. So let's see how well he does on Robert Hare's test. And I'm going to be a little bit generous and a little bit harsh at the same time. For several of the items, I'm going to give a range. If I'm generous, I'll score that much. If I'm harsh, I'm going to score another worse thing rather than an individual score. Because we do know that politicians do differ, and some of them are worse on others, and some of them are worse on some and some on others. So, part one, number one, superficial. And if you remember, this is someone who is glib or has a surface charm. Well, whenever I've met politicians, they always go out of their way to be smooth, slick, and charming. Mr. Politico certainly does that. He takes great care over his appearance. He's hardly ever at a loss for words. He's glib. And when he's speaking, this is something very interesting. Psychopaths, so I'm told, often move their hands about more than most people. It's called beats. And it's something that many people do quite naturally. In fact, almost everyone does it. When they're speaking and when they're using gestures. So this is a very common thing for psychopaths to do. My score of Mr. Politico is, if I'm generous to him, it applies somewhat, and if I'm harsh, it applies very definitely. So I score him 1 to 2 on that one. Number 2, grandiose. Are politicians arrogant? Do they think they're superior human beings to others? Well, Mr. Politico wants power, and in that sense, he is arrogant. And he likes to order people around, and he often likes to impose burdens on those he doesn't like. And I was thinking back a little while ago to a slogan, an old Labour slogan that was attributed to Dennis Healey. I don't know if it actually came from Dennis Healey. We'll tax the rich until the pips squeak. That's the kind of thing that many politicians like to do. And when he does get power, well, yes, if you become accustomed to exercising power, that exercise will tend to reinforce the conviction that he is a superior being to those that he rules over. At least I think it will. So again, I'm going to score him, yes, it definitely applies, and if I'm really harsh, or yes, it certainly applies a bit, and if I'm really harsh, it definitely applies in full. So that'll be 1 to 2. Number 3 is deceitful. Lying, insincere, selfish and manipulative, unscrupulous, dishonest. I almost found myself laughing at myself here. Mr. Politico is prone to lying or exaggerating. It's just a common truth. Politicians lie. And people do more to ask why do they lie than to comment on the fact that they lie. And I know, and it's very clear from examples, that many politicians, and Mr. Politico will be like this, are not interested in truth, where they conflict with the politician's policies or with his prejudices. For example, the global warming business, which anybody who knows anything about science and is willing to drill down into the hard evidence knows that the case that human activities, human emissions of carbon dioxide, are causing or will cause catastrophic global warming, there is no case there whatsoever. And yet, all but 5 members of parliament back in 2008, all but 5 of the 458 in the parliament that day voted for the climate change bill. They were not interested in truth. And another example, coming back to Tony Blair, is Saddam Hussein's weapons of mass destruction. He wasn't going to listen to what Hans Blix told him. Another thing Mr. Politico likes to do, with the assistance from his media cronies, is he likes to scaremonger. Again, the climate change thing, it's all down to scaremongering. It's manipulating people's emotions, and it's making people feel guilty. Now, I have to confess, it's not entirely the politicians that are guilty on this score. It is mainly the media cronies, but the media cronies feed off the politicians, so the politicians cannot evade their responsibility for doing these things. Many politicians have little or no sense of right and wrong. Look at the expenses scandal. And particularly when selfish gain is involved, they really don't seem to know what's right and what is wrong. And they often behave as hypocrites. Climate change is used for excuses to make people cut energy use or drive and fly less. And yet, how many politicians and politically connected actually do these things themselves? And I'll take an extreme example, the case of Al Gore, who has about 20 mansions dotted around the states. Many of them are near the sea, so he obviously doesn't believe the crap about sea level rise. He has the biggest electricity bill in the known universe. He rides around in limos and he flies all over the world giving speeches. Al Gore would score 3 out of 2 on this aspect of the test. But Mr. Politico can't score more than 2, unfortunately. Another way in which politicians are hypocrites is they will shed crocodile tears for the poor. They will wring their hands, we should do things for the poor. But all they actually do is make laws that force other people, productive people, to give what they don't want to give to those who are deemed to be poor by the politicians. In other words, those that support the politicians. So I think Mr. Politico scores a full 2 on this one, on deceitful. Number four, lack of empathy. We're talking about lacking sensitivity towards or regard for people in general. Mr. Politico very cleverly makes it look as if he cares about people. Yet he doesn't show actual evidence of fellow feeling, or not much actual evidence of fellow feeling. It's all surface. I will give you an example of the first occasion on which I met my Member of Parliament. My Member of Parliament happens to be Jeremy Hunt, not someone with whom I have very much respect. This was at a meeting he held in the local area before he became a candidate even. It was about 18 months before he stood for Parliament. And it was just after the war in Iraq. And he went around the room before the thing. There were only about 20 of us there. It was a very local thing. And he asked each of us, what do you think I should be doing for you? And at the time, now I'm a victim of IR35, a very bad tax law made by New Labour, which actually tried to declare my livelihood to be illegal. They got away with just making it extremely difficult for me to do my job. And so I said to him, well, I hear that your party is talking about repealing IR35. Can you make sure that that's done? What I got was, in essence, a wave of cold air. He had no interest whatsoever in helping me, no interest in me as a person. It was just, here, I'm not interested in you. It was just, it was an astonishing experience. So that's how politicians have a habit of treating people. Anyway, I'll come back to Mr. Politico rather than a specific one. He belongs to a political party. And what is a political party? It's a gang. A political party is a gang which has an ideology and agendas that it wants to impose on people and wants to get political power in order to do those things. And this applies just as much to the Tories and to UKIP as it does to Labour or the Lib Dems. And Mr. Politico puts what I call great causes ahead of people all the time. Sustainable development, health and safety, national security. I'm going to have to wash my mouth out for this one. Making America great again. All these things are put ahead of people by politicians in general, and my example, Mr. Politico in particular. And so I'm going to score him again, as I have on so many, if I'm really generous, because there are a few politicians who are not quite as bad. If I'm really generous, I will score one, and if I'm harsh, I'll score two. Number five, doesn't accept responsibility. Many politicians will lie to deceive or cover up, and we got all the stuff over the expenses scandal again. Oh, they may go all silence, or they may point the finger of blame at someone else, or they may lie and attempt to rationalise that what they did was right, or they might bluster to try to convince people that they were right all along and they didn't do anything wrong. But of course, there is one kind of responsibility that Mr. Politico does want, and that's the kind of responsibility, in scare quotes, which brings him more power. So I'm going to score him yet again. If I'm generous, he'll get one. It's there, but not fully. If I'm harsh, he's going to get two. It's there, fully. Number six is lack of remorse. Cold and calculating attitude to others, seeming to feel no guilt, lacking concern for the losses, pain, and suffering of victims. Those are the descriptions I gave you a little earlier. Now, remorse, according to Webster's, is, quote, a gnawing distress arising from a sense of guilt for past wrongs, unquote. Mr. Politico seems very happy to harm the very people he is supposed to represent, if their views go against his agenda. And worse, because of the system we have of whips, he will usually vote for the party's agenda, even if it goes against the interests of the very, very people, even his own constituents, the people that he is supposed to represent. And he doesn't show any sense of guilt or distress. You don't, if you watch the news, I don't watch the news anymore, when a politician is interviewed, do they ever show guilt or distress? Very, very unusual. And even when they've just voted for an aggressive war, they've voted to kill innocent people in Iraq or Syria. So again, I'm going to score him one or two. One if I'm generous and two if I'm harsh. So on part One, I score Mr. Politico between 7 and 12. Every single one of the six items applies to him in some extent at least, and at least one of them he has in full. So he's not doing very well at this moment. Anyway, when we get to part two, perhaps I'm going to be a little bit more generous, because I recognise there are certain politicians who do not suffer the second half, the part two things, the things which are not concerned with remorseless use of others as badly. First of all, it's impulsive. They can be foolhardy, rash, unpredictable, erratic and reckless. Typical example of being erratic and reckless is those members of parliament who supported wars in Syria, both in 2013 and in 2015. Because had the 2013 war gone ahead, ISIS would have been allies. And then in 2015 they say, we have to bring down ISIS. Well, wait a moment. That's erratic behaviour. If you don't know who your enemies are, you can't be trusted with power, can you? And in just a couple of years, it is ridiculous that anyone can vote for both. But I will be generous towards Mr. Politico, because there are some politicians, and I think of David Davis as an example, who don't fall into this trap. And I happened to look up David Davis's voting record, and he voted against on both occasions. And only 7 Tories voted against in 2015. So if you want principled Tories, those are 7 to start with. Jeremy Hunt, I looked up his voting record too, guess what? He voted for on both occasions. Anyway, poor behaviour controls, irritability, impatience. There was an absolutely wonderful thing. I won't damage public property by doing it properly, but remember when Mr. Khrushchev at the United Nations banged his shoe hard on the desk? Nyet, 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 nyet. Now, Khrushchev is not perhaps typical, or perhaps he is typical, but I think we have to be worried about politicians that can be very irritable and impatient with people, and people who don't deserve them to be irritable and impatient. And again, I'll score 1. Again, I'm being generous, because not all politicians do that. Number 9, lacks goals, can be a parasite. Well, in one sense, all politicians are parasites, because they live off taxation. And often they do have goals, but unfortunately they're not positive goals. They are goals of imposing policies on us, on people. And I think of forcing us out of our cars and into public transport. That's all part of the Enviro stuff. I think of banning fox hunting. It was just done for the hell of it. They hated the kind of people who hunt foxes. Banning smoking in pubs. Again, they hate the kind of people who like to smoke in pubs. They hate the real ordinary people. And again, there are politicians who are not entirely evil on these things, and I will give Jeremy Hunt 1 plaudit. He has actually run a business in his past. So he I score as innocent on this particular one. But again, Mr. Politico is going to get 1. Number 10, irresponsible, making promises, conveniently forgetting them. Another one I have to wash my mouth out for, George H.W. Bush. Read my lips, no new taxes. Well, we all know how true that turned out to be. I was actually living in the US in 1990 when he went against that 1988 promise. And Cameron, having promised a Brexit referendum in 2010, very nearly got away with it. He got re-elected without having done it between 2010 and 2015. It's only because he got overconfident and made some commitments he then couldn't get out of that we had a Brexit referendum. So, the last two, adolescent and antisocial behaviour and adult antisocial behaviour, well, I'm not going to insist on these ones. My view is that Mr. Politico is probably not guilty of either of these two, but if he was, the story would probably have been suppressed by his party. But parties, from what I know, because I do have a friend who looked to stand for Parliament, the parties are, they do look into their candidates' backgrounds quite rigorously. And, of course, the one I didn't mention, or the one I mentioned but isn't in the test, promiscuous sexual behaviour. And there's a certain Clinton, Mr. Clinton, who is quite famous for this, and in this country there was, many years ago, certain Mr. Profumo, I seem to remember. For any of us who are old enough to remember Mr. Profumo, I'm just about old enough to remember. So, Mr. Politico score on part two, and I'm being really, really generous here, is 4 or 5. I'm getting behind myself, so I'm going to have to speed up. So he scores 7 to 12 on the first part, 4 to 5 on the second, 11 to 17 in total. The middle of the range is 14. Robert Hare's cutoff score for a potential psychopath is 13 plus. So my cardboard cutout of a politician, Mr. Politico, is a potential psychopath. He is a potential psychopath. He's bad. He's not the kind of individual that any peaceful and honest human being like me would ever want to associate with, let alone vote for. That is my view of the typical politician. Of course, I'm not a trained psychiatrist, so my doing the test has no weight. A trained psychiatrist might come up with some much more generous viewpoints. And I recognise that I am not completely objective about this test. However, it was not my purpose in life to become a trained psychiatrist, and I would recommend that if you look up the PCL screening version, which is it's available, you follow the links from Robert Hare's website, and you can get to at least papers that list it. You can't get to the actual document. Then you can actually score people, and you can make your own judgments. You can score your Member of Parliament, for example. Jeremy Hunt, in my view, is somewhere between 8 and 11. So he's not actually a potential psychopath, but he's still pretty bad. Or you can store historical figures. Hitler, or Stalin. Or, oh, what about Tony Blair? There's a historical figure for you. Or you can, if all else fails, you can score yourself. Robert Hare has gone on record scoring himself as 4 or 5. I think he's probably very ungenerous. Probably. I score myself at 2, and I'm certain which 2 I possess. I can have lack of empathy, particularly with people who are not very empathetic towards me, and I can be impatient. So I score 2 out of the total possible of 24. Now I have got to the point where I couldn't avoid having one slide, so I did make a few copies. There aren't quite enough to go around. Could you hand those out?
Yes, certainly.
Because this is a really, really, really important graph. And now, yeah, there's about one between two, slightly more than that. So, I was absolutely astonished when I was browsing through Hare's papers, and I came on this one, because it comes from a paper co-authored by Hare. If you were. Anyway, I'll go on. It's almost getting round to you. What this is a graph of the scores. The scores are along the bottom axis against the number of people in a control sample. And this was from a paper published by someone called Neumann and co-authored by Hare in 2008. Now, the sample is about what they called a comparison group. In other words, it's a random sample from among the general population in a particular geographical area, because they were studying violence in a particular geographical area. 514 people from among the general population, both white and black, and Hispanics. And it was taken in 2001 as part of a study on violence in the USA. And there are some absolutely astonishing things you can see in this graph. 36% of that sample, that great big bar on the left, 36% scored 0 on the PCLSV test. 0. They haven't got any of these 12 bad things. Not any of them, not even once, not in any way. That is astonishing. Even more astonishing, 50% scored 0 or 1. Having been trained as a mathematician, I tend to talk in terms of means and medians, and the median is the 50% point. The 50% point score, the median, is 1. The the exact 50% point in the middle of the population, that person scores one on this sample. Only 6% scored 11, which is my lower bound for Mr. Politico's score, or more. Only 1.2% were potential psychopaths with a score of 13 plus. You'll have to trust my addition here. And less than 0.5% qualified as actual psychopaths, which is a score of 18 plus. And to me, that vindicated the UK psychologist's view of what is a psychopath rather than Hare's original estimate in 2001. So that's why I changed my view as to what the estimate is. And let's remember that Mr. Politico's score, his midpoint score, was 14. So he's in the worst 1% of the population. Now, just a little aside about the distribution of scores among criminals. There was a study done in New Zealand, and this was a PhD thesis. Again, you can find it on the internet. There was a sample of people who had previously been convicted of violent crimes and had been released, and they were given the screening version of the PCL test, and this showed a roughly uniform distribution. The number of people scoring high was much the same as the number of people scoring something much lower. There was a slight bump in the middle and towards the high end. And if I'm really, really, I'll just take David's copy here, but if you look at this, at the curve that you see in the population here, I'm not being rigorous in any way about this, but could there perhaps be two slightly different populations that we're talking about? Normals, who have a very shaped distribution that starts very high and goes down very low, and then some people with something wrong with them who start very low and build up to a high point in the middle, you know, around the 8 or 9, and then go down. So the right hand of what you see here is due to the people who have got this thing wrong with them, and the left hand side is mostly due to the normal people. I don't know. I think that would be a very incorrect, politically incorrect suggestion if someone did make it formally. Anyway, why does power attract psychopaths? It's one of the questions that I ask myself. Well, it enables them to live out their grandiose delusions of superiority. If you give a psychopath, and I think we can be fairly clear that Hitler, for example, was a psychopath, he can live out his fantasies to the full. He can start wars. He can commit genocides. He can treat the little people with disdain. He can tax and plunder people out of existence. He can make bad laws that harm us and that violate our rights. And as likely as not, he'll get away with his crimes. Okay, there are a few politicians who didn't get away with their crimes, and I think of the example of Ceausescu, but most politicians, a great majority, do get away with their crimes, even in democracies. And the political state, let's face it, the political state could also almost have been designed as a vehicle for psychopaths. Where does the idea of the political state come from? Well, it comes from the ideas of a fellow called Jean Baudin. I don't know how much you know about him, but he was a Frenchman who lived back in the 16th century. And he was actually quite an interesting thinker, but his purpose was to try to shore up the power of the French kings in a quite nasty time around the Reformation. And we are still using such a system. I mean, it's been hacked around, and we've got bags on the side like parliaments and bills of rights and all kinds of stuff like that. But we are essentially still using Jean Baudin's system. It gives something called a sovereign, a government or a parliament, supreme power over everyone else in a territory. And it does. Parliament is supposed to be sovereign. Yes. And it gives it a right to make laws to bind the people. It gives it rights to make wars. It gives it rights to levy taxes. And it gives it, ultimately, no responsibility for the consequences of what it does. Of course, if you said, well, Parliament today acts as if it has sovereign immunity or as the king can do no wrong, they'd say, no, it's not like that at all. They deny it. But they do. Take, for example, the killers of Jean-Charles de Menezes. What was done there? That was definitely worthy of a life sentence. In my view, they were not even prosecuted for the actual killing. They were given a health and safety ticking off. In fact, some of those responsible for that killing got promotions. So that, I think, is some evidence that the political state could have been, could almost have been designed for psychopaths. And we need to change that. And worse than that, getting political power selects for psychopaths. If you can get power by military force, as used to be in the old days, then psychopaths have an advantage because callousness, deceit and remorselessness are very effective in war. And where power can be got by sucking up to a ruling establishment, psychopaths also have an advantage. Psychopathic rulers tend to attract and to be attracted to others like themselves. So once you get a psychopathic ruler, who will he want to pass his power on to? Another psychopath. I call that the birds of a feather flock together syndrome. And democracy too selects for psychopaths, would you believe? Glibness and superficial charm. They're attracted to voters, aren't they? If you want to persuade tens of thousands of people to vote for you, or hundreds of thousands of people, as they have in the US, or millions of people, it's a lot easier if you're charming. And the political parties provide magnets for attracting and training new psychopaths. Again, this is my birds of a feather syndrome. And those few decent non-psychopathic individuals who do acquire some power, and yes, there are some decent MPs, I'm not sure how many. I would say there are at least a dozen on the Tory backbenches. Maybe as many as 30. And there might be, well, not anymore, but there might have been some on the Lib Dem backbenches. But they get pressured to conform. And however talented they may be, and however fine individuals they may be, they become either corrupted or sidelined. And again, I think of David Davis, who seems to be a fairly principled person. Why has he never been even offered the chance of a shot at party leader? Because he's not one of them, is he? And another problem, it's a problem inherent in democracy, that it gives apparent legitimacy to bad policies, as if they were the will of the people. Now, democracy is the will of the people, except when it comes as a result of as a referendum like Brexit, but that's another story. There's another Frenchman who has a lot to answer for here, a certain Jean-Jacques Rousseau, based on his idea of the general will. The idea that a diverse society of 60 million people can have a general will seems to me to be complete, total rubbish. But who am I to criticise these things? Anyway, to come towards the conclusion, the nub of the problem is that we have a government or governments. And there are governments all over the world like this, which are run by ruling classes that include far too many individuals with psychopathic tendencies, either psychopaths or near psychopaths. And that is not a recipe for a free, just, honest society. So in the words of Vladimir Ilyich Lenin, I thought I'd get my quote in from the left, what is to be done? Well, my thinking is, could we perhaps hoist government on their own petard? Because they're very often they like to claim a right to act to protect us. They should be protecting us from paedophiles or whatever flavour of the month is. They maintain barred lists of people not to be allowed to work with children. They maintain no-fly lists of people who aren't to fly in planes. Well, I'm not going to address the morality of lists like that. And I'm certainly not going to address whether government is the right organisation to maintain them. But if we agree that it is okay for government to do this kind of thing, then why doesn't government maintain a barred list of those who are not to be allowed into positions of power? I hoped I'd get a laugh there, but I didn't. And I'm not just talking about political power, government power of any kind. So let me make a suggestion with my labial organ, firmly in my buccal receptacle. Number one, all candidates for political office should have to take the PCLSV screening version test. Two, those above a cutoff score should be barred from office. Three, once proven, this scheme should be extended to all candidates for positions with any government power. That's my suggestion. What should the cutoff score be? Well, if politicians in democratic societies, if politicians are to represent the people, then they must be representative of the people, must they not? And 50% of the people score one or less on the test. So the cutoff score has got to be low, because no one who is a psychopath or anyone near it can possibly represent any of these people. I regard myself as an honest person, and I regard the system. It cannot possibly represent me because I am not dishonest. Suggestion, then, the maximum score at which anyone should be allowed power should depend on the level of that power. A national political level, I put forward a suggestion of 2, although there is a good case for saying 1, because that's the median point. 50% of the people score 1 or less on the test, according to that sample. And at president and prime minister level, should be a maximum of 0. And later, perhaps, and of course, I'm putting forward wild ideas here, any government job with any power at all, we might put a maximum on of, 4 or 5, and any government job at all, maybe there should be a maximum score. I'm not going to say what I think that should be. But of course, no one in the political establishment would possibly listen to ideas like these, because they are the self-serving beneficiaries of a system that selects for them. And they would have a lot to fear from such a test, at the very least, end of career. Of course, we'd have to do things to make it happen, and it's not going to make it happen, and it's not going to happen, at least in that form. We'd need to sell to a wide public the idea of testing people to avoid the selfish, callous, remorseless, irresponsible individuals being allowed into positions of power. We'd have to make the test utterly foolproof. We'd have to organise the test to maximise its objectivity. For example, we might get around problems with biased psychiatrists, because it needs a psychiatrist, by having a judge and jury system where the psychiatrist takes the role of judge and ordinary people take the role of jury. And we need to develop just means of removing or blocking individuals from office if they fail the test. And by just, I mean that their careers outside government should not be destroyed, because no one, in my view, has any right to destroy the career of any non-criminal individual. And I'm very strong about that, because my career has been, in effect, destroyed by IR35, so I'm very strong on that point. To sum up, 1, the meme that politicians are psychopaths is an oversimplification, but it contains a substantial kernel of truth. 2, those in or seeking power are far more prone to psychopathic tendencies than the population as a whole, with obvious negative consequences for us all. And 3, my suggestion for a possible step forward, tongue very firmly in cheek, is to institute testing to screen out psychopaths and potential psychopaths from among those seeking power. And I'll finish merely by saying thank you to David for inviting me here. Thank you to all of you for coming. And questions, please.
Any questions?
Oh, I'm sure there will be questions.
Thank you for your presentation.
Well,
I just wanted to totally
it. Thanks.
So how would you support Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump?
I did actually, now I'm working from memory here because I don't have the slides of the presentation with me. I did, the opening slide of my presentation has 3 former US presidents in it, and current ones. So it has Clinton, it has Obama, and it has George W. Bush. I scored Bush at 13, I scored Obama at 14, sorry, I scored Clinton at 13, I scored Obama at 14, I scored Bush at 15. And again, this is on the Mr. Politico test from what I know of them. I don't know them as individuals. As far as the 2 candidates this time, my impression is that Trump is bad in different ways from most politicians. So he would probably have a comparable score to those 3. Hillary Clinton, I think, is worse than any of them. But who am I to criticize American politicians? Yep.
Yes. Thank you for the talk. Very interesting. I wonder if people scoring 1 or even 0 could actually rule, make decisions, and get things done. So maybe one needs a schedule for what a good politician needs to have it ought to be a good politician rather than having nothing at all. So there are possible models that one could generate to say, rather than going down for the lowest possible score, say, well, if this person has these traits and these relationships, and perhaps this is a person best fitted for the job of being a politician, if we want such things. So that applies to other roles as well.
Yes, I mean, that's a very good point. In fact, I was... Just this very morning, I read the first chapter of a new book by Jason Brennan called Against Democracy. And he makes pretty much the point that you're making there in that. I think... I'm not actually sure that people scoring zero or one could... these people necessarily are unable to get things done. I can get things done in business... And I only score two, and that's on my own measurement. So I'm not sure. What I would suggest is it might be good to look into the psychological research. I doubt that anyone has actually done research to answer your question. I would think that with a gut feel, people of who are scoring low but able to do it would exist, maybe in a small minority. And I think, I haven't read the whole book yet because I've only read the first chapter, and I think Jason Brennan may be coming out moving in that direction.
So you could take a person whose traits are, should we say, useful in the role they play, not harmful necessarily, but they are a good example of a model, and then assess them for what is, or what their shape is.
It's a way, yes, I mean, it's a way forward.
Bob, and then Steve, and then Nico.
I think if the idea of this test were introduced, it would be used by the sort of people you describe to give out people who are superior to themselves.
Okay. That's exactly what my worry about, not about my version of it, but
they would have, yes.
Yes. Well, it could very easy to misuse things like this, and that is why I said we have to make it foolproof. And that's why I talked about judge and jury.
Yes.
Yes. So... I have done a little thinking about this, not a huge amount.
Steve?
A lot of the characteristics in this test seem to be applicable not just to politicians, but they might be quite useful in climbing the greasy pole anywhere, whether it's in politics or in business.
Yes.
And you said you could get things done in business, but could you climb to the top of a firm, you know.
No.
I know I couldn't.
No, I'm an individualist.
But, yeah, okay. But, you know, there may be a large firm which someone might want to reach to become a managing director of, say. And these qualities would be quite useful. They are just sort of Machiavellian qualities, really.
Yes.
And I think it's a bit misleading, this whole thing, actually, for libertarians. And that the real problem is not so much that people do possess... unpleasant qualities. It's that they get the use of the state and force to carry out wishes. So, for the fact that someone wants to harm computer contractors or whatever, well, so what? You know, it doesn't matter. But if he gets into power, he can bring an IR-35. That's the crucial point.
Yeah, I did make that point, but I think it goes further than that. The current political system selects in favour of psychopaths gaining power, even democracy.
What I think is that any big, reasonably sized organisation, bureaucracy, would also require these sort of people, or at least some of the qualities in these people. Although I think the market would also act to make them not just parasitic.
Well, yes.
Nico?
Yeah, I was, because of you said a cutoff of, should be low for politicians, and I mean, you must have heard the expression, evil comes from good intentions, and I firmly believe that's true. I'm not sure which I should fear more, the psychopath who's just interested in himself or the people who want to save the planet. I think the latter might actually be much more dangerous
But the people who want to save the planet score high on the test because they want to do things with people. They want to do things against people's wills.
No. I think that's a misunderstanding of this psychopathy test. Because the essence, this test is not is designed to identify to find psychopaths. But psychopathy itself is a lack of empathy of no having emotional attachments to individuals. And in order to find these people, he has made this score. So I think people with empathy can be very, very dangerous people.
That is true.
I think the political process is as Stephen was saying, the political process is just inherently bad, no matter who comes to
power. I mean, for example, if we take your average enviro. Let's say an enviro person has huge empathy. They want to save the world. Are they deceitful? Well, yes.
They're deceitful.
They will lie about the so-called science of global warming in order to try to make.
They believe it.
Objectively, it's a lie.
It can't be. They don't lie when they say it.
It can't be a lie unless it's deliberate.
Yeah.
In a falsehood, it's not a lie. Well, I honestly told you that I'm the greatest man on earth. I actually believe that delusion. It's not a lie, it's a falsehood, of course.
There are some exaggerations for good ends. There are some people who know that they're really laying it on. But we have to get the public worried for their own good. So in a sense they're lying. Well, they're lying.
They are, yes.
But they're just exaggerating. But they may truly care for everybody else.
But they're still deceitful in the sense of hers. So I'm just a lack of remorse. Well, nobody has worried too much about the I think the statistic is grossly overhyped, but somebody worked out that 30,000 people once the climate change bill had gone into operation in the two cold winters we had in 2010 and 11, something like 30,000 people died early unnecessarily because they couldn't afford to heat their homes, old people.
Yeah, but they would argue that in the long run you save all humankind.
In the long run we're all dead. John Maynard Keynes.
That's the only thing you got right.
No, he's
got something right.
No, he did get one other thing right. When the evidence changes, I change my view.
Oh, no, that's false. He says, when the facts change, I change my view.
Yeah, yes, okay,
what do you do? Well, the facts never change.
In the long run, I change my
view. There's someone
in
this room that doesn't understand that.
Because of our policies.
You see, he's defined in this trap of almost associating that the politicians with being bad people, inevitably being bad people. And I think that's a mistake, you know, because, as Nico said, you know, there are plenty of politicians, I think, in the past who at least started out being genuine idealists. And I think that was the problem, really.
Yes, but power corrupts. The moment they actually this is a problem with the human condition. As soon as they got power, even if they were good people to begin with, the very power that they knew would be a problem corrupted themselves.
I'm not disputing that.
Yes, and
quite right.
In fact, I said that because I gave the advantage of David Davis. If someone is not corrupted, and I'm sure there are, as I said, a dozen, maybe 30, decent.
Anyway.
Yeah, and there are probably a dozen or 30 decent people, at least, on the Tory benches. But they never actually get into the central core
of
things. They never get power because they're uncorrupted.
$1 corrupts the human mind. We are, everyone in this room is very smart. But $1 can corrupt the mind.
Make it £2 of a pound.
Mine's a pint.
That costs £3.
It's even easier than that.
No, I don't think money corrupts. Power corrupts, but money, of course, is anarchic, as Marx quite rightly pointed out. But anyway, Bob.
I think most of the population, obviously, is not psychopathic. But they have wrong ideas about the best policies or the best institutions for the people they care for, including themselves.
Yes. Yep. But where do they get these ideas?
Well, from all sorts of places.
From the media, mostly.
Well, no, from other innocents, possibly. You may get...
Yep.
There is such a thing as honest error, even in theory.
Oh, yes.
In fact, most error is honest, even when it's disastrous.
My impression has been that most people get their political knowledge from the media, and the media are known to be biased. Each individual media may be biased, and medium may be biased in a different way, like the Telegraph has a different bias from the Guardian.
I'm not sure about bias. I mean, to be biased is to be. You're going to have some views, you're going to have some explanations. The important thing is that you allow them to be tested, that you listen to people with counter-arguments, that you look for counter-evidence.
Yep. Oh, indeed, yes.
And not...
Factual research, yes.
And not,
yes. Yeah, and you're quite right. People do not do that when they should do.
But they're not wicked, necessarily. They're just...
No, but they're certainly not wicked if they score 0 or 1.
Pat?
Perhaps it's not just psychopaths that are a danger to politics and political science. I mean, what if you had a religious fanatic, for example, who was completely normal and who stood up and said, right, I've got a religion now, conversion or death. You convert to my religion or I kill you.
Well, I think such a person would score quite high on the test. He's certainly impulsive. He'd score on that one. I mean, I could go back and read them out. But he'd score on impulsive. He'd score on lack of remorse. He'd score on doesn't accept responsibility. He'd score on grandiose because he thinks he has a right to do these things. He'd score on poor behaviour controls. So that's 10 points already. He'd score on irresponsible, and he'd score on adult antisocial behaviour. So he's already up there with Mr. Politico.
Well, there's a lot of those people in power,
isn't it?
I don't think they'd be classed as psychopaths. I mean, you mentioned the great dictators, for example.
Yes.
Hitler, Stalin, Mussolini, and so forth. I mean, would they be... Describe the psychopath test. Do you think they would
fail? I'm pretty certain that Hitler would be. I'm not. I don't know. I mean, it was a different situation back in those days, particularly with Mussolini, for example. But I think.
I mean, Franco was a dictator. He was Jewish, wasn't he?
I'm not sure about Franco. I don't know about Franco's past.
He's Catholic.
He was a military officer, yes.
My suggestion to you is to really drill down into the parties themselves. I think you'd probably ship more books if the headline was Tories are all psychopaths or Labourers. Get it right now to do it. You did it with David Davis. I can't see no reason why you can't do it with the other.
It would be possible to do that, yes.
Yeah.
I mean, but then obviously I'm biased because I'm very anti-Labour for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
But I don't like any of them.
And what about the idea of, because I'm a great believer that, because I'm on the momentum, the Labour one of the things, some of the things we're discussing is that all future Labour MPs should accept a living wage, a reduction. From 74,000 people, they get this wage now. And but I just found out from this meeting that money is not the great motivator for
saying. No, but that sounds a good idea.
Yeah, it is a good idea. Thank you.
No, I think you should pay them their whatever it is, but they should then have to pay damages to anybody they damage. Well, government is supposed to be for the benefit of the governed,
yeah.
And that's all the governed. And yes, we can say that there are good reasons why criminals, it shouldn't be for the benefit of criminals, because they have gone against real things that people should not do, not just laws made by politicians. But when, as happens in most political policies, they are designed either to give something to some group. I mean, going back to IR35, my understanding of what happened behind IR35 because it happens all around the world, all at the same time, is, you remember the Y2K bug? Remember back late 90s? Well, in 97, 98, the work for the Y2K bug was being done. There was so much work being done, people were falling over themselves to get software people. People were coming out of retirement to do jobs. There are in the industry a couple of large companies. I mean, we're talking 100,000 employees plus. One used to be called EDS, but they called something else. That's Ross Perot's company. Yeah, and the other's Capgemini, or was Capgemini. What I assume must have happened, because I can't see any other way it happened, could have caused different governments to bring in different laws all to the same effect, all at the same time, in the summer of 1999, was that they lobbied the governments to take away this competition from them. And the governments said, oh, that would be nice, we get more revenue as well. So that's, I mean, I can't prove anything, but that's what I think probably happened.
No more questions. I suppose we'll carry on the discussion in the bar. Yes. Thank you very much indeed, Neil.
Thank you.